All right, so I think the first thing we're gonna do is, because it's gonna take about a minute or two to create a SignalR service, let's do that. So okay. I'm in the Azure portal. It's fairly easy to do. I search for SignalR, and then I say I want a new thing. So I'm just gonna go and create a new resource crew, a Web Wednesday. And maybe I'll call it Web Wednesday.
Very creative in the names. I appreciate that.
I try my best. Actually, yeah, like when I code, or well, now I, as a PM, I code less. Naming is the thing I hate the most. I always ask someone else for naming.
I feel that.
And then I'll, I'm going to pick a location nice and close to me. And then I'm going to pick the free tier. And then down here, yeah, hopefully this is big enough. I'm trying to make it bigger.
There you go.
And there's the default and classic. I don't need to explain to you what they are, because we're not using them today. We're going to use a serverless one. That's the one where we can use with Azure Functions.
Okay.
And then I'm just going to go ahead and create it after, yeah, the button lights up. Okay, so it's going to go off and get created. I think in probably a minute or two, we should have one. So while that's happening, let's take a look at how we can work with it from Azure Functions.
Okay, let's build an app.
All right, so I'm going to assume a little bit of knowledge of Azure Functions. Even if not, I'll try to walk through a little bit of it. So in Azure Functions, the first thing that you need to do is create what's called an app. And then within an app, you can have more than one functions. And these functions are serverless. And I'm going to be running these locally on a machine right now. And then some of the other demos I'll show are actually going to be running in the cloud.
Okay.
So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to say create a new project. And this is using the Azure Functions extension in VS Code. And I'm going to choose this folder that I already created. I will use JavaScript. And let's see, what should I do? I will... I need to switch to a different set of templates so I can see everything. And I'm going to choose this thing called the SignalR Negotiate HTTP Trigger. It's a really long name. Funny enough, I think I added this item to this menu and I named it. So see, I shouldn't be trusted to name anything. And I'll quickly kind of talk about what the negotiate thing does. You kind of can ignore it when you first get started with SignalR. But basically, in order to kind of figure out for basically the browser or the client to figure out, you know, where your SignalR service is, it needs to first call an endpoint to figure that out. And that's what the negotiate endpoint does. It's actually part of the SignalR protocol. So the first thing that it does is actually going to make an HTTP post to an endpoint. And by convention, it needs to be named negotiate. We have documentation and all that. But then you don't have to do a heck of a lot in an Azure Function app for this to work. You can see that using a template, we already kind of created an HTTP function. So this function would just become an HTTP endpoint in the cloud. And it's going to because the route is negotiate, it's going to be at, you know, slash, you know, whatever HTTP, whatever domain name I get for my function app, /API/negotiate. And SignalR service will just know how to talk to it. I'll show you kind of that piece of the code in a bit. And then down here, we're basically getting access to this thing called a connection info. And what this thing does is that it kind of gives you this payload that you need to return back to the client, so that it knows what to do with it. And again, you don't have to worry too much about how this works, because most of it is kind of done for you in the by the templates. But you do need one of these things. And typically in here, if you need to assign a connection to a group, or connect, well, basically, or you need to associate a connection to a user so that you can only send messages that are only going to be received by a user, you might need to do a little bit more stuff in the negotiate function. But typically, if you just want to do a broadcast to everything that's connected, you don't really have to do anything here. You just kind of take everything as is, and that's that. So, and should I run it? I'll run the whole thing in a bit later. So the other thing that I want to kind of show you now is, with the negotiate function, what that allows the browser or any client to do is to connect to SignalR service. So the next thing, you know, actually the real thing that your app wants to do is actually, you know, when something happens, whether it's because you receive an HTTP request into your function app, or your function app could be listening for queue messages, for example, And then every time you get a queue message, you want to broadcast that out over your WebSocket. Or it could be a change over Cosmos DB, or it could be a change in blob storage. Basically, any trigger that you can set up in Azure Functions, you can basically turn around and when one of those events happen, turn around and send a message to all your connected clients over SignalR. So I've seen stuff like for instance, moving stuff around in a map, right? So imagine you get an event every time an airplane moves in the sky. You can actually take that and broadcast that out to browsers, and then you can actually paint that plane moving on a map. So things like that. It's pretty flexible. But for our purposes here, because we're building a chat app, I will just create an HTTP endpoint. And how do I do that? Say create function. And then I just want an HTTP function. And I'm going to call it messages. And anonymous is fine. We don't need security for a demo. Okay. So let's see. What should I do? So this is just a plain HTTP trigger. So it's going to become an endpoint at /API/messages. And the idea is that every time we want to send a message, we can post to this endpoint. And the body of the message will be, the message itself, I guess.
Okay, so people aren't going to call the negotiate directly. That they're going to do everything then through this this Azure function.
Yeah, so this is the thing that actually does most of the work, which is relaying a message, from one client to everybody else. It'll make maybe a little bit more sense once we kind of fire it up and see it run. But what we need to do now is that we need to use what's called an output binding for this. So I'm going to say add a binding, and I want an output binding, and I want a SignalR binding. And then the naming thing again. I'll call it messages or message, new message. How about that? And I think I'm going to say default here, but I'll tell you why. So SignalR has a concept of hubs. So you can actually divide a single SignalR service into multiple hubs. So you can try to think of them as namespaces. So if your app happens to support both like a real-time chat kind of a thing, but another part of your app might support like a little, real-time notification, a little, changing like the number of messages that appear in the corner of your screen or whatever it is, you can actually have two different kind of hubs, we call it, to take care of each of those types of messages. So you don't have to worry about using a single hub and figuring out, this message is actually a chat message. This one is actually a notification. You don't have to worry about any of that. You can divide it up into multiple namespaces. And I'm going to call this one a default. And I'll tell you why in a sec. And then I need to just give it a setting name. And I'm going to call it Azure SignalR Connection String.
And that app setting is going to be on the server or in Azure. I shouldn't technically say on the server because it's serverless. But that's where it's going to sit there, and it's going to store then the location of that SignalR service, correct?
Yeah, it's actually it's going to be a connection string. It's going to include both the location of it as well as a key.
Okay.
And then the app setting value, I'm going to skip that for because I need to figure out what that is. And I'll probably want to do this off screen because I don't want to show you what that is. So that's done there. Also another long name. Again, I came up with that name. So basically anytime you see a long name, I probably had something to do with it because I couldn't figure out how to make it shorter. I'm okay with
long names. I mean, if it's something that's going to be automatically filled, or especially if it's something that, there's some form of an autocomplete or IntelliSense, long names are okay. Like, I would much prefer a longer name that describes what it is than a short name where I'm having to figure out what in the world it's supposed to do.
Okay, that's good. I named this binding new message. So in here now, I can pretty much get rid of all of this. So the first thing that I want to do is get access to the body of the request. So I'm going to say const just message equals request.body, I think. But that'll give me basically the body itself. And I actually don't really want to do anything with it. You can do some validation in here if you want, or you probably should, because anyone can send anything to this thing. But again, demo, no security. So I'm just going to relay this back to all the connected clients. So in order to do that, I would have to talk to the context, which gives me some bindings. And then for these, for the new message binding, because that's the name I gave the SignalR output binding, I'm going to assign it to an object. And I can actually assign it to an array. If I want to send a pile of messages out all at once, I can actually use an array of these objects, but I'm only going to send one. So I'm just going to just have an object. And this object takes two things. And again, like this is all in documentation, so you don't have to worry about memorizing it like I have here. So the first argument, I guess, that it needs is a thing called a target. And that is really a name of an event. I'm actually going to call it new message as well. So that's just an event's name. Don't have to worry about too much why or what that is. And then arguments. And then the arguments is an array. And then I'm just going to pass the message. It's only going to have one argument, but it can have more.
Okay.
And that's it. So that's really all the code that we need to send that message. So one thing that I'll do here, just kind of
making the case for using TypeScript here, because then I could, create the interface for what new message is going to be. And I can, then of course know what my rec is, because I can add in the type hint and all of that. So if you haven't already started using TypeScript, you should definitely use TypeScript.
Yeah, I'm okay with TypeScript. I think we had this conversation last time about how I have I wouldn't say love hate relationship, but I'm kind of like I can go both ways. I kind of like the simplicity of the JavaScript as well. I'm just gonna create a very simple HTML page here as we're kind of chatting to kind of show you how to now use an HTML page to connect to SignalR service. So I'm going to do a couple of things before that. So in my local.settings.json, this is where we configure that Azure SignalR connection string. So you can see that I kind of pasted in a connection string. You can't see the key.